Buenos días a todos. Estamos muy complacidos de tener aquí al profesor Robert Merton. Él es Distinguished Professor de Finanzas en el Sloan School of Management de MIT y además es profesor emérito de la Universidad de Harvard de la Escuela de Administración. La investigación del profesor Merton se concentra en teoría financiera, incluyendo el tema de hoy sobre cómo manejar las finanzas para el momento del retiro laboral. Además, él ha hecho contribuciones sumamente importantes en otras áreas de la teoría financiera, como el manejo óptimo de portafolios, la determinación de los precios de los activos y derivados financieros, el riesgo crediticio, la innovación financiera, entre otros. El profesor Merton ganó el premio Nobel en 1997 por su contribución en el desarrollo de la fórmula Black and Scholes, que permitió estimar el precio de los derivados financieros, y además él ayudó a generalizar esta fórmula para otros instrumentos financieros, tales como las hipotecas, que es de lo que vamos a hablar hoy. Su trabajo ha sido fundamental para el desarrollo de estos nuevos instrumentos y facilitar el manejo del riesgo. La presentación de hoy será sobre Reverse Mortgage, a Potential Global Solution for Funding Retirement. Professor Merton, we are indeed honored to have you here at the Universidad de Los Andes. Please.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming. Okay.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
The microphone's working. Very good. Thank you. It's a great treat to be here. So let's get to work. Before talking about the subject matter of the talk, I thought I'd say a few words. After all, I'm here in a university with students, about the field of finance and how you could think about it, one, in the broader scheme of what its importance is, and two, some of the aspects of it in terms of a profession. After all, many of you are making decisions as to where and what you want to do in the future, so I thought I'd take a few minutes to do that, okay? Now, to perhaps locate it for you in a broader sense, probably about half a century or more ago, the economist Robert Solow, also a Nobel laureate, developed a growth theory, how economies growth and development. And in that, he came up with a startling result at the time that economic growth was not driven by population growth. It wasn't driven by high rates of saving. Those are important, but not. It was driven by technological progress. The development of technology that allowed the economy to grow with the resources it had better. In other words, you got more from it. You got more from labor, you got more from capital. And he tested it empirically. Now, how does that relate to the field of finance? Well, you can have wonderful ideas. You know, scientists find wonderful new technologies and engineers. But if that science and technology ideas cannot be implemented into the economy in a large way so as to have impact, you won't get growth, even though the theory, the technology is there. A central role of finance and the financial system is to permit the execution, getting of ideas into practice. Things such as, where do you get the money to build these things? Who takes the risks, and how do you distribute them? Now, there are many other important parts of the financial system, payment systems and so forth. Even though it's an intangible, that is to say, you can't see it, it's not like this desk, it's very, very important. Another Nobel laureate, Douglas North, received his prize for work in history, in which he documented that those economies that have well-functioning financial systems were the ones that were able to grow and develop the best. And that's all in background of the importance of finance as a field to our society. Now, let me say a little bit about what finance is. Finance is dealing with, you know, if you were to go into become a person working in finance, the roles of finance are, as I mentioned, finding efficient ways of transferring risk, which can have enormous impacts on efficiency, providing funding and so forth. And it is a, has the following characteristics. It's technically pretty complicated among the different things. It is a technically complicated field. The challenges that need to be solved are big ones. For example, we're going to talk about retirement and how you fund it. The problem in retirement is, look at you, you're not thinking about retirement, are you? You're thinking about building your careers. But one thing that was true 100 years ago and will be true 100 years from now is true here in Colombia, it's true in Brazil, it's true in Japan, and it's true in the United States, that you will always have to somehow provide for retirement. It's a core piece of the life cycle of humanity. How you do that changes over time and space considerably. The problem is, I look at you, and I'm trying to figure out, how can we have you, say, contribute money from your wages every year into a retirement plan for the next 40, and I'm going to talk a little about background longevity, 50 years of work, okay? It sets at the end of that, you can have enough to be able to have continue living in a style for which that life standard that you've become accustomed. That's a very complex technical problem. Think of the amount of uncertainty. Do you know where you're going to be or what you're doing 10 years, 20 years, 30 years from now? No. Somehow we have to design a way of dealing with all that uncertainty, and at the end, from the inputs of your saving, out comes a retirement plan. Very complex technical problem. So those of you who like complex technical problems, those of you who are trained in optimization or mathematics or want to learn about that, you find those interesting problems. There are many such interesting problems in finance, not just retirement. The second feature of it is it's global. It is really true. It's not a thing. The financial system is global. The profession is global. Routinely, our students from MIT, wherever they come from, let's say they're from the US, they may go to work in New York, their company will have them go to London, Hong Kong. It's pretty much the same everywhere. Rules are a little different. In some cases, of course, languages are different. But the way you do finance is really the same thing. And it's all connected. And in the most part, that's improvement. If you have a world connection, you can spread the risks of every economy better than if you only concentrate them. But with each of these improvements comes challenges. It is more complex. Actions taken in the EU can impact what's going on in Asia, Singapore, Korea. Why? Because of these connections. So it's a bigger challenge. But on the whole, it's a very interesting field. It involves high tech. It involves very challenging problems. And it's global. So if there isn't work in one part, there's always something going on somewhere in the world where your skills will be useful. And so if those are the kinds of things that intrigue you, and if you do a good job at it, you're contributing in a significant way to society, that's not bad. That's what's driven my excitement for nearly, I've been teaching and in the practicing world for 45 years, and I'm not retired yet, and I don't plan to. It's too exciting, there's too much to be done. Well, I've taken time on that, but I thought here on this occasion, I had a frame for you this. Now, the many challenges we see out there, and I've chosen one to talk about, retirement, and then a part of the potential solution. Of the many challenges out there, they're big. You know it here for what they are. I just came from Ecuador. They have other ones, Chile, some have in common, and so forth. But there are also great opportunities to address these. There are technologies that exist, market-proven technologies, that have not yet been brought to bear. So when you see all the scary challenges, you know, big things that you face, be aware also that these also present opportunities for you to be a part when you go out there of solving them. And there's a lot to do with it. One of the biggest global issues is how do we fund retirement? And that's in what I will talk about, and then I'll talk about one aspect of that. The global challenge of funding retirement, there are several pieces to it, and each of the countries are addressing it now. Just about every country in the world, large and small, is facing this challenge. And all of them are trying to do things about it. And so this is very topical. In fact, I will confess to you, earlier this morning, I had a breakfast, private breakfast, with about 12, 14 people from here, representing government, the industries, and so forth, in which we were talking about the broad challenge of retirement, but we had a discussion of what we're going to talk about today, reverse mortgage as a particular one. So what you want to understand is this is a challenging problem. I hope you found it interesting. This is what was chosen for me to speak about. But understand, this is really happening. And that's another thing about the field of finance, and you think of academic disciplines, is maybe a little different than even other parts of economics. The most advanced work finds its way into the direct application much more rapidly, literally applied, the modeling and the techniques and so forth. And that's exciting. So where do we do? What is the global challenge? Well, there are many different things, but first of all, it's coming from something that's good news. And I want you to, when you hear all the bad news, forget it. The good news is we're all living longer. That's almost uniform. There are a few exceptions. Almost uniform around the world. Longevity has gone up. Now, you may say, that's because you're at the beginning. I'm here. Extra longevity, I really appreciate. Okay? So this is good. The fact that we can live longer is good news, as I say here, and that it's increasing. And the second piece of good news, broadly, and this doesn't apply to everyone, and this is part of the issue, is that while we're living longer, we're also having longer active lives. It isn't just our heart is beating, or our brain is having young signals. I'm sitting there like this, not moving for 10 years. But you can actually get out and be doing things. You can be active. And part of that is benefits of nutrition, medical care, and medical innovation. Some of it is drugs that allow us to live longer. Others are actually physical things. In other words, the ability for me, let's say, to do physical activities has improved, let's say, by things like hip replacement, where once your hip goes, it's pretty hard to do a lot of things. Today, it can be replaced, which allows you to do it. So do you understand what I mean by these advances in medicine? So that's generally a good news, all right? So that's nice. Now, understand, and I'll say this in front, the distribution of these benefits is not equal among everyone, and that's something that needs to be addressed. Clearly, wealthier societies, economies, within an economy, people with higher resources have better access, whether it's the medical or whatever. And that needs to be addressed. But that said, globally, the longevity is going up. And the fact that the technology exists to do this means that even for those who don't now have opportunity, there's the prospect of creating that opportunity. If you don't have a solution, then there's nothing you can do. If there's a solution, then you can try to find a ways to have it done. Okay, so all of that is the good news. What's the bad news? On average, each of us, that counts every one of you, think about this, each of us, on average, has to pay for the consumption we do while we work, the work years, and our consumption we do when we're retired, we stop working. So our life, after you go to work, you have the work period, the retirement period. We have to make enough, on average, during our work years to pay for all work and retirement. This is simple arithmetic. Now, we can redistribute. I can give you some of mine to someone who needs it more than me. But on average, that's how it gets paid for. And so what does it mean of the implication for retirement if we have an increase in longevity? Well, very quickly, if I work 40 years, please forgive me, I'm doing this in my head, So don't think of the numbers as being precise. It's just so I can do the math without it. Okay, so humor me. I'm sure some of your professors do this sometime. You work for 40 years and you retire for 10 years. Let's say that's the past, the current generation, maybe my generation or one before me. So what does that mean from what I said? You've got to make enough in 40 years to pay for 50 years. Well, the arithmetic is pretty simple. If what you save plus what you consume is equal to what you earn, then you have to save enough in the work years to pay for the 10 years that you're not working. And if I have to pay for 50 years with 40 years, it means I have to save 20% of what I make to pay for the 10 years. 20% of 50 is 10. So, there's interest and stuff. Let's simplify it. So we now, in this hypothetical world, we have a stable, on average, where people save 20%, and they're able to consume at a level of lifestyle of 80%, whatever that is. You see that? Now, suppose suddenly you announce, congratulations, you've got 10 more years to live than you thought. That's good. Smile, please. It's boring. But what is that implication? If I still just work 40 years, then I have to pay for not 50, but 60 years from my 40. Again, simple arithmetic. How can I do that? I'm going to have to save a third, 33% of my income to pay for those 20 years that I don't work, which means I'm only going to be able to consume 67. I mean, it has to add up to 100. 67%. So what is the effect? If I keep the same years of working, what's going to happen is I'm going to have to save more, but what else? I have to reduce the amount of consumption I have, my standard of living. But I get something back. I live longer. So it's, remember, I want to keep reminding you, all of this is basically good. It's just a challenge. Now, maybe we don't want to quite consume less. You kind of don't want to have to live at a lower level, even if you live longer. What can you do about it? Well, the only thing you can do about that is to say, I have to work longer. If you work longer, then you have more years to pay for the same 60. If we wanted, for example, to keep, I know you're not doing the math in your head, but just listen to the music. If you wanted to keep the 80 that you had before and the extra life, then it means you have to, the most you can save is 20 because you're going to consume 80. Remember, that's, so what does that tell you? You're going to have to work for 8 extra years, not 40, but 48. And then you get 12 years of retirement, which is more than 10. So that's good. But you got to work 12 more. I mean, you have to work 8 more years. So that's a way. Now, that's a choice. I'm not saying you have to. But these are the choices that society and individuals have. So what can we do to address the problem beyond that? If we can find ways to improve the benefits we get from the assets we have, the savings you make from working 40 years or 48 years, if we can get more out of it, higher returns, more benefits, then that's a way in which we can have, to some degree, greater longevity, good, and not have to sacrifice standard of living and not have to work quite as much longer than we would in the example I gave you. So that's what I want to talk about. Are there other things we can do to improve the way we handle this retirement problem that will allow us to not have to work quite as much more, not have to give up quite as much consumption, and then walk away? I'm not going to go through this list because that's not what this talk about. This is retirement. But I need to do this for you to understand the importance of this problem and view this as a kind of case study, a strategic research site for what finance is about. It's about innovation, solving problems, finding better ways to do things, to make things better for people. And this is one example, but it's a very important one in my view, because it's a big one that could do a lot for not just one country, but for many of the countries in the world to provide that extra way of getting things beyond saving more, lower, working longer. You're still going to have that happen, is reality, but maybe not as much. And the way to do that, as a practical matter, and I will say, my mindset is I'm an engineer. I've even had a couple of degrees in engineering along with economics. So engineers, there's no such thing as not a solution. You may not like the solution, it may not be better than you like it to be, but there's always a solution. And one of the ways that we were thinking about it is, how do we, as a practical matter, get more from the assets that each person has? You know, you accumulate assets, either your retirement account or other ways. How do we get more out of that? What do you mean, more benefits for you? More lifestyle, more paying for your consumption, more efficiency out of it. Now, it depends on the country, but you have working middle class, and what we define as working middle class is different in some countries, and I'm not going to delay. You know what it is. An important portion of the country, not the poorest portion, and it depends where, you know, on the working portion it is, and in the informal economy, which this actually is going to bear on too, you have here, there are other dimensions. But what I want you to understand, for the vast bulk of people, not the rich or even the what we call upper middle class, those who are doing pretty well, they're not rich, but they're doing very well, they'll be fine. I'm talking about the great groups of people, the mass, who are doing fine, but they don't have a lot of extra. These are the people that have real choices to make, real economic things. That's what this is for. That group of people in the world, almost all the personal saving they do during their lifetime, what I mean by that, saving on their own account, not saving that it goes into a retirement account, not benefits they get from the government, but saving, you know, we save ourselves that we see it, okay? In most economies of that group of people, the largest and sometimes the only major saving that they have is the house or home they live in. They acquire ownership. In many, many countries, in Chile, I don't know the numbers here, and it's every country, there's an answer to every question, it's just not the same answer. So the answer in Colombia is not the same answer as in Ecuador or Chile or in the United States. That's good for many reasons, because we're all different. Secondly, it means you all have good jobs. If there was one answer, we wouldn't need to employ you. You know, we'd get the one answer from one person. But the principle is the same. In Chile, 82% of retirees own where they live. Now, it may not be a terribly valuable house. That's a different issue. In Singapore, it's over 90% own. Okay? It is economically the major source of saving, and for most families at retirement in these countries, it's the largest single asset they own. So it's a very important asset. So now, what about this asset? If it's the saving asset, if we need to save more, but we don't want to reduce our standard of living, we always saw we could do that just by saving more, and if then the only way we can do that is to have the same amount of saving, but have that saving be worth more. We get more out of it. The reverse mortgage, and that's a terrible name, by the way. I have to call it this because that's what it's called, at least places like the United States and others. It's distortionary. In Korea, they call it home pension, and it's a much more descriptive term. I like it, but I can't change, you know, you won't know what I'm talking about if I use that term. Okay? The reverse mortgage is simply a way, not the only way, but a practical way in which you can use that important house asset more efficiently to fund retirement, to give them better people, better benefits from what they have, not ask them to save more and more. Now, we'll need more of these things. This isn't the only answer. So let me explain to you how it works and why. How it works is the following. When you have your home you live in, that takes care of an important part of your consumption. I don't know what it is here, but in the United States, in CPI, or Consumer Price Bundle, it's about 38% of consumption. So it's a very big part. If you own the house, then you have an annuity. You have, you know, it's, you own that part of your consumption. You don't have to earn it anymore, right? If you own it, you live in the house, you don't have to pay rent, and so forth. Okay? So it's a very, when you retire, you want to own that home if you already do, if you're lucky enough. Because you want to live in it. That's the place you want to live. So you own it. But what's going to happen when you no longer need to live in the house? When you're going to someplace better where you don't need a house? Which is the fate we all face. Then what happens to the house? Well, in an agrarian economy, an agricultural economy, it would normally be something like a house, farm, something that was used. It was passed on to the next generation, and they lived in the house and worked the farm. But in return, when you gave the children the farm and they worked it, they have to look after you as long as you're here. That's a retirement system, the family. It works very well in agrarian economy. It does not work in a society that's industrial. So China, as it moves from being more agricultural or any other country to industrial, one of the impacts of that is that in terms of how we can fund retirement, you can no longer do it the traditional way. Because the children don't move in the house. I won't speak to here. You know better to what extent it applies here than I. That's not the point. But if you ask parents in who live in Beijing, whether their adult children who are living and working in Shanghai are going to move into their house, they'll say no. That's the nature of the change in the system. So what will happen to the house? It'll get sold. Maybe it gets rented out, but it gets sold, basically. It becomes a financial asset. It's not an annuity. It's not whatever it was before. Its character changes. Because if the children or family are not moving into it, it's going to be sold. Whenever that's the case, then you can see the nature of the house is its two parts. It's an annuity for living, paying for the people to live. That you want to keep. But then after that, it's a financial asset, no different than a stock or a bond or anything else that has value. What we want to do with the reverse mortgage is take that part of the value. You see what I'm saying? Here's the whole value of the house. This is the part for the, you know, when you use it for retirement. It's like free rent for your life. But then there's what's left. It's the what's left that I'm looking at. And I want to take that. It has value today. I want to take that value and find a technological way to move that value back in time to when the person retires and give them that value to help them pay for their living. So do you see the trade-offs? No magic. You're giving up the house when you don't need it to have more or to take care of yourself when you need it. So there's no magic. By the way, as an aside, finance is fabulous for having people create magical solutions where you can become richer and happier and everything else with no effort, no extra risk, no effort. And it's a very funny thing. So particularly in retirement, if we have a problem, no problem, we'll make 2% more a year on our investments, no extra risk, no problem, and we'll solve the problem. Where do you get that from? It's magic. It doesn't exist. What I'm showing you, therefore, so you understand it, it's not magic. You see where the value is coming. I take that value or a portion of it, move it back to here. By giving that up, I get something I can use here. It's a better, more efficient way of using that asset for that person. Okay? Now, how do you do that? Well, now we get to the technical parts of this. You can't read this. I did this. I'm sorry. These slides were put more to be given to people to have while I talk, but I never use them much of anyway. They just, you know, as I've said much of what I've already said to you, so you can see I wasn't really using the slide. So I already said in words what the purpose and how the basic idea of how it works, what we're trying to achieve. Then how is it done? I'll tell you exactly the way it works. He owns a house, a home, apartment, whatever. He owns it. He's just retired. He wants to get some more money to help him pay for his living now that he's not going to work. He didn't have enough from his retirement savings, you know, what I showed you before. So he comes and he says to me, what's a reverse mortgage do? And I say, I will give you, based on the value of your house, your age, I'm going to give you this money, you know, I'm lend you this money or give you this money, and you're going to sign an agreement that you're going to pay me back that money with some promise interest. Let me just say 10%. Let's say it's $100,000 that I give him, just so I can do the math. You know, $100,000, and it's 10% interest. Then he agrees that he owes me $100,000 plus 10%. That just sounds like a regular loan or mortgage, right? Okay. Everybody said that's the rule. But now, what else is true? He pays me nothing. None of the principal, the $100,000 owed, or any of the interest, the 10%, until he leaves the house. As long as he lives in the house, he pays nothing to me. I'm the other side. This is critical. So if he lives to be 120, as all the good books wish us, he will not have to pay me until he leaves the house. But when he does, he, well, or his estate, because usually he's leaving the house because he's gone to that better place, he owes me 100, compounded at 10%, because he's never paid me any interest, which could be a very big number, you know, if it was many years, right? But that's what he owes me. But that's the first part of it. The second part is, it's non-recourse. Which means whoever is looking after his affairs, call it his beneficiary, because he's left the house because he's better someplace better, his beneficiary has a choice. The beneficiary could pay me what's owed, the $100,000 plus the interest, and then the beneficiary has the house, you know, just like a regular. But the beneficiary, let's say that amount, because he lived very long, and the interest growth of 10% was more than the growth of the value of the house or whatever. Let's say the house is not worth as much as what's owed. Do you understand? So maybe you owe $200,000 and the house is worth $150,000. The beneficiary can say to me, sorry, I don't want the house. Take it. But I take it. Now I take it away from him. He gives it to me. You understand, this is not like the mortgage when I come and throw people out of the house because they can't pay. He's telling me, take the house, because he would rather have me take the house that's worth $150,000 than pay me $200,000 and then get the house, right? That's common sense. That's part of the contract. So nothing else in his affairs is affected by this. That's called non-recourse. Those are the two key features. Look at it from his point of view. Suppose he had a twin sitting next to him. Not living in the same house, but with the same kind of house next door. And they're exactly the same, they're twins. They're both 65, they're both this. He does the reverse mortgage with me. His twin says, no, I'm not going to do that. Fine. Let's look at their retirement life. The twin lives on whatever the twin has, a retirement, pensions, whatever. You live on that, plus he has $100,000, right? So he can use that money to live better than his twin. Do you see that? He has an extra $100,000. Now, when he and his twin go to the better place, what happens? The difference is his twin leaves the house, period, to whoever it goes to. He leaves the house minus the amount of borrowing. But for the two of them, comparing their lives, not after their lives, do you see that he's better off? Because he had taken no more risk, right? because remember, I can't make him pay anything as long as he's in the house. So it's not like a mortgage in that sense. But do you see how it accomplishes what I said? It takes that part. The reason I'm willing to lend to him, because I believe there's going to be value in that house when he no longer needs it. Otherwise, I wouldn't lend him the money, right? And that's my judgment. I'm a professional. I mean, this is what I do for a living. I make a judgment of what I think that's going to be worth, how long he's going to live. I take the risk. I have a price in there. I may have a high interest rate. He doesn't care what the interest rate does he? Because he never pays it. What he cares about is getting as much money as he can. And that's why you want to design this differently than you often think of loans. You want it to be as big as possible, because that's going to give him the most. He'd rather have 120 than 100. And he doesn't care if he pays me 12% versus promise, remember, not, no guarantee, 12% versus 10, which means if the house works out, I'll get 12 versus 10, but I lent him more money. Do you see the trade-offs? Does you get the feel of this? Do you see that that accomplishes at the first pass what we were trying to do? We set out. We haven't changed him. We're not asking him to change his style of life. All his saving was done through that feature. Okay? So that's the essence of what the reverse mortgage is. It's the idea. Will everybody do it? Not probably. I actually believe, though, in those parts of the world where people do have real estate ownership where they live, and they need to live somewhere, this is going to become one of the key means of funding retirement in the future. It may be designed a little differently. It may, I hope, better. You understand? I'm not talking to you today. There's one design. I'm trying to show you how you use finance, innovation, and ideas to improve things for people. It's the same house that his twin had. He saved the same as he did. So we haven't changed anything about behavior. That makes it very practical. But he's better off for what he wants. And that's, I believe, going to be why I take you through this as an exemplifying case. Now, I talked to you about a few minutes, we get 10, yeah. I talked to you about this for 15, 20 minutes. It always seems faster for me, slower for you. You're sitting in class saying, oh, and I'm up here, oh, I got another 2 hours for it. But let me just, you know, ideas are important. Creative ideas are important. It's very important to have the research. But as what I said about with the solo thing with innovation in general, if you can't implement it, if you can't actually make the reverse mortgage become available in low cost, available to people, real people, people who could understand it, set up so they're protected from being, you know, defrauded and so forth. Those are all huge challenges, and they always show up in retirement because we have to deal with everybody in retirement. And I don't care if you're a 180 IQ physicist at MIT, one of my brilliant colleagues. Doesn't mean you know how to do finance. So it is very difficult. You can't expect people to all be educated to it. So you have to design something that works for people without them having to be able to do their own mathematics, you know, solve their own problems. The same way, I don't know how to do surgery. I wouldn't know how to put a hip in. I wouldn't even know how to choose which type of metal to use in the hip. And I'm not going to go to school and learn that so I can do my own surgery. So you have to have highly trained specialists in this. But you have to have a way to transmit this, communicate it to it, market it, educate it to people so they can effectively use it and that the products that they get do what they're supposed to do and they're well made and they are efficient. That's the goal. That's the challenge. And there are a whole host of things you have to do. What do you do when he gets the 100,000? Does he go out and buy a big boat or throw a party for the family? He's never had that much money. If he does that, he's given up the benefit for his retirement. Do we have it go into an annuity, which is insurance company provides a contract that will pay him extra money every month for the rest of his life, like a pension? That could be. There are all those things. How do you design that? There are all the regulations. Clearly, if you're going to do this for large parts of the population on something this important, You have to have oversight, regulation, but it has to be intelligent regulation. If you put in the wrong regulation, you can stifle being able to do this. So the regulator has to understand what this is supposed to do and has to understand technically what's going on. Because many intuitive ideas of what's safe that you put in actually have the unintended consequence of not allowing you to do the best thing. Not because it's more risky, but because it's the wrong regulation. If you're going to produce this pipe, I'm going to be the one giving him money. I better understand an awful lot how to analyze what I get back and when and how much in order to figure out what I can give him and stay in business, which means making a profit and paying for my expenses. If I give him too much and I'm wrong, I'll be bankrupt. Competition, if it's there, will make it that I have to do it the most efficient way I can find or I'll be out of business too. But these are all complications that come in. So I've talked through much of this on the slides. Good, because you can't probably. Well, you have better eyes than I, but you have to be pretty good back there. And those who are watching this on the screen, God knows. So I wanted to get across to you the following important things, that the characteristics are, I already mentioned, for this kind of product, the retiree doesn't care very much about the interest rate. You saw why, because he doesn't pay it. But he cares a lot about how much you can give him in front. Whereas for a regular mortgage, you care a lot about what you're going to pay, because you've got to pay it along the way. And you want to be safe, and you want to don't borrow too much. So there's an answer to every question, and there's a good product to address every question. The answer isn't the same answer. You can't have a knee-jerk thing. You have to address each one as it is, and that's the message here. Then, you know, these are, again, the funding. I would love to talk about, because part of it is, where are you going to get the money? Who are going to be the me's in this? If the entire economy is going to do this on a regular basis when people retire, where does the money come from? It means you have to solve the funding problem. I don't have time to go into it, but that can be done. So funding, education, regulation, efficiency, distribution, ideas. Understand the marketing so people can understand why this fits. A lot of challenges. But this is an engineering problem, not a science problem. Science problems are cold fusion. We don't know whether cold fusion will exist as possible for limitless energy. That's a science problem. I've laid out for you, this can be done. This can be done today. And there are reverse mortgages in the world. They're not particularly well done, but they are there. And I can also tell you, as I said at the beginning, there's huge interest. I've been all around the world in governments around, particularly in Asia, where the Asia is going on, in doing this kind of thing. And I presume that was one of the reasons it was selected. But I want to close and shut down so I can turn down, take some questions, and then go on to the next part of my discussion. I want to close down by saying, think of this as important as this problem is, and it's a very interesting one. When you want to do a school project, if you're interested in this in economics, why don't you work on what are the issues you'd have to do? This is how you learn. You play with it. How would I go about? What would I have to do? How would I explain what I would? How would I figure out how to do this? Not in all the minute details. You don't have that training yet, and it takes a big team. But you could work on this problem as a project, just to learn. But this is the kind of problem that I love, and I think others in the field, because it's big, it's important, it's challenging, it's doable, so it's not Don Quixote, the windmills, okay? It's doable, and if you do it, you'll have an impact on millions of people for decades. They won't know it, but you will. So someone says to you, what did you do with the last 10 years that you were working? Made things a bit better for an awful lot of people for a long time. And I got paid for it. Now that's pretty good. So think of this as a case study, because there are many other such problems. Payment systems, how people can save, how you can help the low end, all these things. And the reason we can do more now than we could in the past is because of technology. Computing power, cheaper computing power, big data. And finance technology evolved. So this is why I said at the beginning, this is an exciting field. So I will stop with that. I hope that I inspire or stimulate some of you to think about maybe this isn't such a bad part of economics. And this is very practical, but also for those of you who like intellectual challenges, very much that as well. So thank you. I'm happy to take questions if, however you want to do it. So thank you very much.
Two questions. That's very interesting, and of course, this provides an alternative option for pensions. One question is, how do you deal with house price cycles? Because when you're going to get the amount up front, I guess the price of the house at that moment is critical, whether it goes up or down. And the other one is, how do you deal with the infinitely lived agents, in the sense that it seems that the trade-off between the twins is not whether it's whether I get more money now or whether I leave a higher bequest for future mm-hmm. generations.
Very good question. Everybody hear the question? I hope. If not, you did not. Okay, two parts to it. The first part was the price cycles. What price is it when I retire? The second one is, he's better off, but his beneficiaries of the twins are better off, so it's a different bequest. Both very good questions, and they're part of that marketing you would have to do so that people would accept it. You have to answer that. So housing prices. To the extent that you have a pension system now in which some of that comes from DC, not all of it is just guaranteed income while you're working. I'm not talking about if you retire. So part of your income is a guaranteed benefit, or you buy an annuity or something like that. It's not annuities, but it's something like that. Where you can buy risk-free. If you were in U.S. dollars, you could buy a U.S. Treasury TIPS, which protects you for inflation, with a full faith and credit of the U.S. government in dollars, and you know you're going to get your payment. But the return on that is low, so you need a lot to buy that. So some people, when they're working, they take some risk in their pensions. Pension, they don't manage it, but the people, they invest in stocks or real estate, risky assets. So what you get, forget the house, what you get when you retire is a function of what happened there too. The house in that sense is no different. Now, you're quite right. If you wanted to start hedging the house, that could be done for you too. And that's a good question. That's what engineering is about. You've got a problem, we figure out how to solve it. We're in the solutions business. That's what engineers do. That's what I mean as a mindset. But you see that it's not that different from everything else. So it's just, it's just another source. It's not an alternative to pension. It's an addition to the pension. We're not saying not do pensions. We're saying pension, but you don't have enough from the pension. Therefore, this is a way to get more, so you can have a better retirement. Okay? That are the beneficiaries. Very good question. All the children are going to say, this twin is the smart one. This twin went, no, dad, mom, don't do this. Why? Because they're likely to get the house. Well, there's some part of that's true, but let me show you that if the children say, don't do the reverse mortgage, let me first show you that's a bad for not just the twin, it's bad for them. Bad for us? Yes, why? He's 65. So his child, let's say, is 39. Maybe a little younger, maybe a little older. Child's 39, typically. Two children, maybe 9, 10 years old. It depends on the society, but you see what I'm saying. Now, this twin wouldn't do it. And he says to his child, 39-year-old, two children, at an age when they need a lot of things, they're not little, okay? Someday, maybe a month from now, or maybe 25 years from now, you're going to get your legacy. So it's a lottery ticket. You're giving them a lottery ticket. And what's really bad about it is a lottery ticket, I think, not financial. How does the child win the lottery? The parent go to another better place. I don't want my children saying, Dad, I think it's time. So I'm just giving you the psychological. But now let's go to the financial. All I want to show you, because I'm don't have the time and I want to get this. All I want to show you is the following. I can do something better than the advice that the child said, don't take the reverse mortgage. We know if he doesn't, he's going to have to live on just whatever else he has. So let's agree. So I say to the beneficiary, the child, forget your parents. Whatever we get from the reverse mortgage, remember that $100,000? I'm not going to give it to your parents. They don't care because if they do what you do, they wouldn't have it anyway, right? We're going to give it to you. Now, you're 39-year-old, two children, middle of raising them, and you have a choice. You can have $100,000 right now to help you raise your children, pay for the housing, your housing, not your parents, yours. And if the price of the house goes way up, you know, maybe you think, real estate's going to go very high in Colombia. It's going to double, triple. Fine. Then when he goes, you pay off the loan because the house is worth so much. And you still have almost all the gains. So you get all the great rewards. So what you get in return, instead of the lottery ticket, $100,000 now that you can use, and you don't have to wish anything, and what's called an option or a call on the value of the house later. I submit that I could convince some of you to take that over. Not. All I wanted to do, and I quit on this because of the time. All I want to say to you is, if I convince you something better than not doing it, now we have a basis for a discussion between the beneficiary and the others. And it may be a balance. Maybe he gives some part to the children now and keeps it. But I remind you of one last thing. If you fly on an airplane, a commercial airline, you always get all the instructions. And one of them is, if the cabin drops and the thing drops out of the ceiling, you push for the oxygen. You ever seen the pictures of that? You know, okay. What do they, first of all, they always have a lady, a woman, and a little girl sitting on the seat next to them, obviously her daughter. And when it pops out, what do they say always? Do your own first, then take care of the child. Why? Because if you can't take care of yourself, you will never be able to take care of the child. I say the same. If he can't make it through retirement because he doesn't have enough resources, he should take care of himself first. This $100,000 is not to go out and have a luxury. Most people are not going to see this as a luxury. They're going to see that they don't have enough otherwise. This is not about buying a boat or having two cars or even having a car. It's about having enough to have a decent retirement. I submit that she has to take care. If there's stuff left, give it to them. But it's a choice. Anyway, thank you very much.
Bueno, muchas gracias a todos por asistir hoy a la conferencia, que estuvo sumamente interesante. El profesor Merton y Heidi Pickett van a estar acá atendiendo estudiantes que quieran información sobre la maestría en finanzas de MIT, así que los que quieran se pueden entonces quedar.
Am I still on or did you shut me off?
Sorry.
Am I still on? Can you hear me? As she's going up, I wanted to connect what you're about to see. To do this reverse mortgage, all the stuff that I've dumped over, takes a lot of skill sets. This you don't learn in an afternoon. You have to be well trained. And what we're talking to you about is kinds of education and programs that exist that give the kind of training for young people to have the skill set so they can solve these problems. I just want to put in context. Sorry, go ahead.
Great. Well, welcome everyone. I'm so pleased that you're able to attend today's presentation with Professor Merton. In addition to traveling throughout your region,